Hi guys, I'm Ben from AdaptLux, and today I'm taking a look at ultraviolet-induced visible fluorescence photography. It's a bit of a mouthful, UV-IVF photography for short. Now, if you don't know what that is, I recommend going and taking a look at the first part of this video. It's a two-parter. In the first part, I'll explain a little bit about what UV photography actually is and the differences between the two different types. So if you've not seen that, I recommend going and checking that out first. I'll link it at the top of the screen now, and it'll also be in the description. In this video, we're going to be taking a look exactly how to achieve UV fluorescence photography. And we're going to be shooting these lilies here. So I'm going to get started setting up in the bathroom here, and I'll tell you exactly why I'm here in just a second. So why am I here in the bathroom of all places? Well, there's a perfectly good reason for it. At the end of the last video, I mentioned that we're going to need a couple of things in order to achieve UV fluorescence photography. The first one is a pure UV light source. Now, we have that in the form of the AdaptLux Studio and our UV lighting art. The other thing, though, is darkness. So this is the darkest room in my house. And even then, I've had to block up a skylight so that there's no light coming in through there at all. You're going to need the same thing. I'd recommend that you go out and find a really dark space to shoot in and have some lights around that you can switch on and off. So just a quick note before we start using the UV lighting arms, and that's on safety. UV light, it is harmful to your eyes. It's why we have sunglasses. It's why we have sunscreen and sunblock. So I do recommend using some eye protection at the very least when you're using UV light like this, particularly if you've decided to go out and get a modified flash. There's a lot more intensity of UV light comes out of those than out of our lighting arms. Still, even with the lighting arms, I recommend some eye protection. My glasses actually have some UV coatings on them, so no UV light passes through there. You can go out and get some UV protective glasses for a couple of pounds or a couple of dollars online, and those will be more than sufficient to protect your eyes from the UV light. If you wanted to look particularly cool, just wear your sunglasses. That's exactly what they're designed for, is cutting out UV light. Before I turn out our lights, I want to show you our subjects in a bit more detail. So we've got a lily here, which is really quite nice. It's got a lot of different hues and colours in there, and this pollen all around the centre here is going to fluoresce really nicely as well. I've also got some orange ones. I'm not quite sure what these guys are going to do, but I would imagine that the pollen will glow quite similarly to the other one, and this one's actually got quite a lot of pollen down on the petals as well. Now, a lot of subjects, they fluoresce quite nicely, particularly if they're alive. So flowers and plants, leaves, insects as well. If you can keep things steady enough, they're going to produce some really interesting effects when you put them under UV light. I recommend just grabbing stuff from your garden and putting it under the UV light, doing what we're going to do today and seeing what the results are. There's nothing quite like when you take your long exposure and the image pops up on the back of the camera, and it will blow your mind the differences between what we can see with our own eyes and what we see with a long exposure using UV light. I'm going to start setting up our camera and tripod and lighting so that you guys can see exactly what you need to be able to create a UV fluorescence image. I've got my flowers out. I've got a few different types. I've given them a little bit of a prune and taken away some extra leaves and foliage and things like that, just to clean up our shots a little bit. But before we set up a composition and start shooting, I just wanted to run you through this setup. Now, if you've already got a setup for shooting your subject in a conventional way, and you can transplant that into a dark environment, then by all means, definitely do that. I'm shooting flowers here, so I've got my telephoto lens attached so that I can get nice close into the flowers while still getting the entire flower in there. So I'm not using a macro lens just yet. We might be able to go a little bit closer in a little while. But the important parts here are the tripods, the stabilization. Because we're going to be taking quite long exposures of, say, 30 seconds, you're going to need that stabilization. Whereas if you are shooting using conventional light, you might be inclined to, handhold the camera, go freehand. Here we're going to need tripods. So I've got my camera sat on one tripod here, and then I've got my lighting sat on a separate tripod over here. Now it's fully possible to pop the Adaptalux Studio onto the top of the camera and get a little bit closer. Like I say, I want to be quite far out so that I can get shots of the entire flowers. Now that's exactly what I'm going to do. I'm going to compose a few shots here, exactly like I would with normal light, taking into consideration where the UV lighting arms are pointing, where the shadows are going to be falling with that UV light. It's still going to behave like normal light, it's just going to look as if it's coming from the flower. So if you've got a stem that is lit from one side, it's going to leave a shadow on the other side. So just bear things like that in mind whilst you're composing your shots. I'm going to take a few initial shots here and see what kind of results we've got. Now that I've got a good idea about what my lilies are actually going to look like under the UV light and how they're going to fluoresce, I can recompose my shots and really start to explore some of these flowers. And I'll be doing that in a minute. I just want to give you a really quick walkthrough of what I'm actually doing, the process that I'm going through to get these shots. Now, kind of hard to show you in the pitch darkness, which is what it's like when I'm actually shooting. So I'll give you an explainer and I'll tell you what's going to be different as soon as you turn out the lights. So using the setup that you've just seen, you can compose your shot. That's the first thing that you're going to need to do. And like we've already said, you can do that exactly how you would any other shot for the subject that you're shooting. So flowers, I'm using the telephoto lens and I want to get quite a lot of the flower in focus. Now, speaking of focus though, that's something that you're going to need to think about before you turn out the lights. Obviously, as soon as you turn out the lights, your autofocus isn't going to work, you're not going to be able to look through the viewfinder, and you're not going to be able to focus on anything. So before you turn out the lights, make sure you've focused on the spot that you want to be focused on, and you can flick your camera over to manual mode and then it's not going to change. Obviously, if you're already on manual mode, that's great, you just need to turn out the lights once you're focused. Now, usually I don't like going on about settings too much. A lot of people find it kind of boring, and it's also completely different for every scenario, every shoot, and every subject. It is worth mentioning here though, because the two things that you're going to want to be able to control are your ISO and your aperture. Your shutter speed is going to be fine because you're sat on a tripod. That's going to happen no matter what, so you can push your shutter speed as long as it possibly can go. So 30 seconds for convenience, that's what most cameras go up to. If you really need it, you can go to bulb mode and get some extra. You shouldn't need it using, say, two UV lighting arms. Your ISO is going to be a bigger concern though. It's going to bring in a lot of grain, especially on a long exposure shot. The longer the exposure, the more grain it's going to gather, so you're going to want your ISO to be as low as possible. I've been shooting around ISO 200, 250, maybe pushing up a little bit higher if I need a little bit more brightness out of the certain shots. And I'll be continuing to sort of change that up and down just slightly as I change my shots around. The other concern is your aperture. You want a pretty good depth of field for something like flowers. So I've been shooting around f8, which gives me a decent depth of field and enough of the flower in focus. Obviously, if you're not that bothered about your depth of field and you can open up your aperture all the way, then absolutely do that. You can then bring your ISO all the way down and you can maybe even bring your shutter speed down a little bit, just so you're not waiting around quite as long. Obviously, if you are wanting your maximum depth of field and you're going to go sort of up to f22, then you're going to need to think about raising your ISO a little bit or lengthening your shutter speed. So those are just a couple of considerations with your settings. With the shot that I've just got, you can see that it's actually sat on, well, it's sat on a little salt rock type thing that I found in my bathroom. And you can see that it's actually fluorescing a little bit. So that's the next thing that you're going to need to think about when you're setting up your shots. Is there anything else in your environment that's going to fluoresce? Now, in my bathroom, which is painted almost entirely white, there's quite a few things in here that will fluoresce. The little boat down in the corner, he fluoresces, so I've moved him out the way because you can see him hanging around in the background of some of our shots. And things like the tiles, if you're too close to something that's white, it's going to fluoresce, and it might fluoresce more than your subject. To get a nice dark background, I've got quite a good distance away from anything in that background that might fluoresce as well. So with our settings and our environment in control, we're pretty much ready to expose. Now, the last thing that you need to think about is turning out your lights and pressing the shutter button. It's easier said than done in pitch darkness. It's very easy to knock a tripod or fumble your camera so that your focus is then out. I recommend using a shutter release cable. This is a pretty bog standard one, but it just allows you to plug in and then press the button without having to touch your camera. It means no camera shake and no risk of messing up your exposure by fumbling around too much. It also means that you can maybe have one hand on your light switch and then the other hand on your camera without having to stretch too far or risk knocking your camera. So with all of that said, it's time for me to start experimenting with my lilies. I want to get lots of different shots of all of the different types of lilies. I want to get nice and close in and further out and capture those details on all of the petals. And I want to move my lighting around to create some really interesting effects. Now I've got three UV lighting arms, and I might not be using all three of them for every shot, but the objective I'm going for is to be getting those UV lighting arms in as close as possible to the subject, and just getting them into position where they're not seen in the frame, but they are as close to the subject as possible. So I'm going to start experimenting, moving my lighting around, moving my camera around, and changing my subject. And let's see what we can get using these UV-IVF photography techniques. I can't really explain to you guys the feeling when you see these images pop up on the back of your camera after your long exposure. It's so, so interesting to see what your eye can't actually see. And I guess that's part of the reason that a lot of us enjoy photography, particularly low light photography, nighttime photography, all of these sort of fringe types of photography. Really, really interesting, at least to me. Now our lilies, I'm really happy with these. Like I said at the beginning, they're not the best fluorescing subjects, but they do fluoresce enough for us to be able to capture some really interesting lighting and colours coming up on here. I was particularly interested to see that the pollen doesn't actually glow on these lilies. A lot of the other flowers that I've shot before, the pollen glows quite brightly. So I've got in quite closely, getting all of these little spines and things in here. But I also wanted to get nice and close to that pollen itself and see if it does fluoresce. It turns out it does. It just doesn't fluoresce very much compared to the rest of the flower. So that was really interesting as well. Nevertheless, I've had so much fun shooting these lilies under UV light using the UV-IVF photography techniques that I've shown you here today, which are particularly easy using the Adaptalux UV arms, because all it takes is to cut out some light, take a long exposure, and then you've got this magnificent image of something that you'd never be able to see with your naked eye. Now let us know down in the comments what you think to today's shoot. If you've got any suggestions of subjects that you'd like us to see shoot under UV light, then by all means let us know as well, because we'll be doing more of these tutorials, and particularly macro photography tutorials with UV light in the future. So make sure to let us know in the comments if you've got any suggestions. Make sure to give us a like whilst you're down there and subscribe for some more tutorials in the future. Until then though guys, thanks for watching and I'll see you next time.